thanks for coming. You all know me, I'm Donovan. I just have a few, you know, business things to take care of before we start. First, just thank everyone for coming. Also, there's food and coffee and things in the back. Please help yourself. There's going to be a reception at Dan Smith's house after the lecture tonight. So if anyone needs information, directions, or ride, please talk to myself or to Matthew Kroll or to Dan or to anyone who you know may be going. And we'll help you out with that. Also, we've been putting the lectures and everything up on YouTube, so check out videos on YouTube. We got a Facebook account and a Twitter account, so if you're on any social media, we do a lot of, you know, information through that, so please follow us there. We've got an awesome lineup for the spring semester. Dr. Jacqueline Mourinho will be giving a lecture. Dr. Calvin Schraub will be giving a lecture, probably on Heidegger, since he's teaching the Heidegger seminar. We have someone from Philadelphia who has a fellowship at Montclair doing philosophy with children coming, who's a pragmatist. She'll probably talk about philosophy and literature. Dr. John Duvall from the English department will be here, so we're very, very excited. This is not our last lecture. Speaking of upcoming events, Dr. Chris Young will be giving his lecture on December the 5th. And with that, I will turn things over to him. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, I'm very pleased to welcome Andrew Cutrofello, who is professor of philosophy at Loyola University of Chicago, received his PhD from Northwestern University in 1989, and taught at St. Mary's College in beautiful South Carolina before joining the philosophy department at Loyola. Dr. Cutrofello's interests include Kant, continental philosophy, and metaphilosophical reflections on the history and meaning of the analytic . He's published a number of books and articles, including The Owl at Dawn, a sequel to Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit, which is one of my favorite pieces of American Hegelian drama, and most recently, Continental Philosophy, a Contemporary Introduction, which is also really good, part of the Routledge Contemporary Introductions to Philosophy series. All for Nothing, Hamlet's Negativity, is set to appear next year through the MIT Press. So tonight's lecture is entitled On the Idea of Metaphysical Poetry. Please join us in welcoming Dr.
Shakespeare, but I really haven't worked on metaphysical poetry so much. And so it's a new foray, but I'm sort of bringing it back to Shakespeare in the end, as you'll see. And another problem with this paper is that it's in two parts, and the first part is too short, but the whole thing is too long. So I think I'm going to keep an eye on the clock, and we can decide when I reach the end of the first part, should I just sort of summarize what I'm doing in the second part or not? Yes, just cover here. Okay, so according to Aristotle, being is said in many ways, but there's a primary way to which the other ways are commonly related, or as he says, a pros and equivocal. So by implication, there's a primary sense of metaphysics to which other senses are commonly related. Like metaphysics, metaphysical poetry is said in many ways. But is there a primary sense to which the others are commonly related? That's the question that I'd like to try and broach today. I'll begin by saying something about Samuel Johnson's reasons for characterizing Abraham Cowley as a metaphysical poet and for denigrating Cowley's metaphysicality. Then I'll have something to say about T.S. Eliot's rehabilitation of 17th century metaphysical poetry and Eliot's eventual discernment of a higher type of metaphysical poetry in Dante. Then I'll turn briefly to Paul de Man's implicit characterization of the Romantics as the true metaphysical poets. And then on the basis of a shared question about the nature of being, I'll compare de Man's deconstructive poetics to the Quinean poetics that José Benardete applies to the first line of Homer's Iliad. Finally, introduction to his influential metaphysical lyrics and poems of the 17th century, Herbert Gerson distinguished metaphysical poetry in the full sense of the term from the poetry that Dr. Johnson had dubbed metaphysical. Quoting Gerson, "Metaphysical poetry in the full sense of the term is a poetry which, like that of the Divina Commedia, the De Rerum Natura, the De Natura Rerum, perhaps Goethe's Faust, has been inspired by a philosophical conception of the universe and the role assigned to the human spirit in the great drama of existence." Gerson is somewhat less precise about metaphysical poetry in Johnson's sense, but he stresses, quote, "above all, the peculiar blend of passion and thought, feeling and ratiocination," unquote. While he appears to be trying to distinguish broad and narrow senses of the term, Gerson's somewhat vague characterization of the narrow sense highlights the difficulty of understanding what exactly Johnson did have in mind when he characterized metaphysical poetry as metaphysical. When Johnson called Cowley a metaphysical poet, he did not mean that Cowley wrote poetry that was inspired by a philosophical conception of the universe and the role assigned to the human spirit in the great drama of existence. That was something that Cowley's contemporary John Milton did, but Milton was no metaphysical poet in Johnson's sense. Cowley was metaphysical, not because he wrote poetry about metaphysical topics, but because he wrote metaphysically about whatever topics his poetry happened to be about. Metaphysicality was a matter of form rather than of content, in other words. To write metaphysically meant for Johnson to write, not just for Johnson, to write wittily. The nature of wit, and hence of witty writing, had been a contested topic in the 17th century. Some critics relegated it to the status of mere verbal cleverness, but others represented it as the intellectual ability to bring things themselves into harmony with one another. As Cowley himself wittily argued in his Ode on Wit, quote, "'Tis not when two like words make up one noise, jests for Dutchmen and English boys, in a true piece of wit all things must be, yet all things there agree." In his Life of Cowley, Johnson criticized Alexander Pope for effectively reducing wit to jests for Dutchmen and English boys. Pope, quote, "depresses it," that is wit, "below its natural dignity and reduces it from strength of thought to happiness of language," end quote. Despite this defense of Cowley and wit, which implies that wit has a metaphysical dimension insofar as it deals with things rather than with words, Johnson goes on to criticize Cowley for pursuing wit for wit's sake. Specifically, he criticizes Cowley for dissevering wit from sensibility, for seeking, quote, "rather to impress sentences on the understanding than images on the fancy." An additional fault of Cowley's was that his sentences were difficult to follow. To understand him, readers had to exercise their own wits. Cowley should have displayed the intellectual goal that his own wit had mined in clear and elegant terms. Instead, he buried it, according to Johnson, quote, "in unrefined and plebeian words that none but philosophers can distinguish it." These two faults, scanting fancy and obscuring sense, made Cowley more of a versifier, in Johnson's opinion, than a true poet. True poetry required that wit be exercised in tandem with fancy and elegance. Fancy and elegance with wit might be superficial, but wit without fancy and elegance was too metaphysical. Quote, "wit abstracted from its effects upon the hearer may be more rigorously and philosophically considered as a kind of discordia concourse, a combination of dissimilar images or discovery of occult resemblances in things apparently unlike. The most heterogeneous ideas are yoked by violence together. Nature and art are ransacked for illustrations, comparisons, and illusions," end quote, in the passage from Johnson. Thus, metaphysical poetry in the Johnsonian sense came to be understood as poetry filled with clever conceits, apt but bizarre comparisons, such as John Donne's famous likening of the mixing of bodily fluids during sexual copulation to the experience of being bitten by the same flea. If the charge of superficiality lingered up until the time of Grierson, it was in part because the point of such comparisons wasn't to reveal deep identities and differences, but only to note metaphysically superficial resemblances. So sort of compare the use of compare in the directive compare. conceits. Excuse me, what, of course, Johnson is saying, to draw witty contrasts, for the poet to tell us, for instance, why the right eye of his mistress is entirely different from her left, or why an object and its mirror image are utterly dissimilar when considered from a certain point of view. Such observations would count as witty in the modern sense of the word, but apparently not in Johnson's or even in Cowley's. For Johnson, wit was exclusively a matter of violently opening together the most heterogeneous ideas, not of violently dividing the most homogeneous. Drawing distinction was the prerogative of a different cognitive faculty, namely judgment. Carefully distinguishing judgment from wit was something that 17th century English philosophers were doing at the same time that their metaphysical compatriots were writing their witty poems. As Locke explained in the essay concerning human understanding, for wit, lying most in the assemblage of ideas and putting those together with quickness and variety, wherein can be found any resemblance or congruity, thereby to make up pleasant pictures and agreeable visions in the fancy. Judgment, on the contrary, lies quite on the other side, in separating carefully one from another, ideas wherein can be found the least difference, thereby to avoid being misled by similitude and by affinity to take one thing for another. So wit's facultative opposite wasn't fancy, exactly, as Johnson would maintain in his aesthetic assessment of metaphysical poetry, but judgment. As a natural philosopher seeking to understand the nature of human understanding, Locke was exercising his own capacity for judgment when he not only distinguished judgment from wit, but ranked judgment higher than wit. Cowley did the opposite in his Ode on Wit, wittily showing wit to advance human understanding more than judgment, which, like a multiplying glass, is liable to generate illusory differences or unimportant differences. By the time Johnson was sharpening his critical pencil, the 17th century quarrel between metaphysical poets and natural philosophers had been largely won by the natural philosophers. But whether we think of Johnson's critique of metaphysical poetry as involving the subordination of wit to judgment, or as the displacement of wit by judgment, will perhaps depend on how we construe the complicated semantic history of the words wit and judgment. Now, instead of going down this complicated lexical path, what I'd like to do instead here is just focus on the differences between an epistemological paradigm in which comparison represents the highest form of knowledge and an epistemological paradigm in which discrimination represents the highest form of knowledge. If this seems like a false opposition to us today, it's because we've become accustomed to the idea that some researchers are lumpers and others are splitters, and that scientific progress typically requires both lumping and splitting. Kant codifies this double cognitive requirement in the Critique of Pure Reason when he represents the principles of homogeneity and specification as complementary regulative ideals. Since the underlying model for this way of thinking is Aristotle's division of natural phenomena into genera and species, it seems likely that neither comparing nor contrasting has ever been pursued to the complete exclusion of the other. However, according to Michel Foucault, an epistemology based primarily on comparison prevailed in European culture from the Middle Ages through the Renaissance, while epistemology based primarily on discrimination came to prevail during the so-called classical age. In the earlier period, the acquisition of knowledge was equated with the uncovering and interpretation of hidden resemblances. And within this paradigm, comparison was more important than contrasting. That is, exercising wit was more important than judging. The fruits of comparison weren't entirely random. Genuine resemblances had to be ferreted out, and once ferreted out, they had to be interpreted. But neither ferreting out resemblances nor interpreting them was a matter of judging them in Locke's sense of the term. Neither involved separating carefully one from another ideas wherein can be found the least difference. On the contrary, the search for significant resemblances involved yoking together heterogeneous phenomena and the expectation that any resemblances that came to light must have metaphysical significance, even if that significance couldn't be immediately apprehended. As Foucault points out, both the strength and the weakness of this paradigm lie in its open-endedness and its endless proliferation of interpretations. Not coincidentally, the proliferation of interpretations is precisely what we expect to find in poetry, perhaps especially in metaphysical poetry, in Grierson's full sense of the word. Metaphysical poets interpret the world in ever new ways, and their poems in turn lend themselves to ever new interpretations. For the purposes of natural philosophy, however, the proliferation of interpretations represents an epistemological obstacle. For the project of early modern natural philosophy to get off the ground, a new conception of knowledge had to emerge, one based not on resemblance, but, as Foucault emphasizes, on the systematic representation of identities and differences. Hence, the prioritization of judgment over wit and the transition from a fundamentally poetic view of the world to one that was fundamentally prosaic, in some sense. If comparison still mattered, as it certainly did, it was not for the sake of interpreting signs and wonders, but for the sake of measurement and classification. Lumpers and splitters belong to a new paradigm of knowledge. To continue to think that wit in the older sense mattered more than judgment was simply foolish. Wit had once been the prerogative of folly, in fact, but now folly was regarded as incompatible with knowledge. So Johnson, I think, belonged to this new paradigm, but so in a way did Cowley. The wit that he praised was already less the hermeneutic ability to decode worldly signs than it was the creative ability to draw unexpected connections. True wit concerned things rather than words, but it remained metaphysically superficial, reflecting the cleverness of the poet rather than the wisdom of God. From this point of view, Johnson was justified in representing Cowley's metaphysicality as a matter of form rather than content. The exercise of wit was a game that the court poet had inherited from the likes of Feste and Touchstone, whose own wit was metaphysical primarily or not exclusively in form. Once again, it's interesting to contrast the royalist Cowley with a revolutionary Milton, whose style wasn't the least bit metaphysical, but whose content was far more so. Grierson goes out of his way to note that, quote, Milton was no philosopher, that he proved nothing because the definitely stated argument of Paradise Lost is an obvious begging of the question. Yet he acknowledges that Milton is metaphysical in a large way that Donne and his followers to Cowley are not. So one way in which Grierson went beyond Johnson was to represent Donne and Marvell rather than Cowley as the leading metaphysical poets. And Eliot agreed. To his court mistress, Eliot observes that while the poem contains wit, its wit is not only combined with but fused into the imagination. Somewhat confusingly, perhaps, Eliot contrasts Marvell's witty fancy with Cowley's alleged overindulgence, not in wit, Pache Johnson, but fancy. Excuse me. Whatever the nature of Cowley's one-sidedness, however, it has to do with what Eliot famously characterizes as the dissociation of sensibility that supposedly afflicted English poetry from the time of Milton and Dryden up until the appearance of Grierson's anthology in 1921. Marvell's witty fancy was of a piece with what George Williamson, under Eliot's influence, called Donne's unified sensibility. As Eliot himself characterized this frame of mind, quote, a thought to Donne was an experience. It is constantly amalgamated, disparate experience, end quote. Here the work of amalgamation is a matter not solely of wit in Cowley's sense, for it involves a fusion of wit and fancy. Although given Eliot's apparent inversion of the terms of Johnson's criticism, it's not entirely clear how he thinks Cowley turns out to be closer to Milton than Johnson thought. But what is clear is that the dissociation of sensibility in Milton and Dryden is supposed to have ushered in a completely different type of poetry, one whose intellectual strengths made it difficult for Johnson and subsequent readers to appreciate what was metaphysically interesting in the best metaphysical poetry. With one or two exceptions, Eliot suggests the romantic reaction against intellectualism was a symptom of, rather than a cure for, the dissociation of sensibility. Modern society had only exacerbated the problem. By going back to the examples of Dunn, Marvell, and Herbert, Eliot argued the modern poet could learn how, quote, to find the verbal equivalent for states of mind and feeling. To achieve this goal, the poet had to, quote, become more and more comprehensive, more elusive, more indirect, in order to force, to dislocate, if necessary, language into his meaning, end quote. In his Clark lectures on metaphysical poetry, Eliot went one step further, representing Dante as the greatest metaphysical poet. Dunn and Marvell united thought and sensibility, but their metaphysicality remained largely formal and unsystematic. So implicitly reviving Grierson's conception of metaphysical poetry in the full or wide sense of the term, Eliot now found in the Divine Comedy a poetic vision that was metaphysical both in form and in content. Just as Milton and Dryden shaped Johnson's critical sensibility, so Eliot shaped that of the new critics. Their emphasis on the individual work as an isolated monad reflected Eliot's conception of a literary tradition as a timeless order of timeless works. The new critics also inherited Eliot's admiration for the metaphysical poets and his disdain for the romantics. The poetic symbols were important not only for their rhetorical significance, but because they exemplified the unity of form and content. Their metaphysical significance consisted not only in their unification of thought and sensibility, but in their concretization of metaphysical abstractions. Though not necessarily committed to a particular metaphysic, the new critics suggested, as did Eliot, that the task of Greek poetry was to unify thought and being. Such, at any rate, was the impression that gave Paul de Man, who objected both to the new critics' formalism, what I would perhaps prefer to characterize as their monadologism, and to the supposition that poetic symbols had greater metaphysical significance than allegories. Allegory was represented, had been represented, as a merely rhetorical literary device because it failed to unify idea and image, thought and being. But against this new critical consensus, de Man held that allegory bore witness to an ontological dislocation that symbolism tried to elide. The new critic who came closest to appreciating the fact of ontological dislocation in de Man's view was William Empson, whose Seven Types of Ambiguity culminates in the thought, here paraphrased by de Man, that, quote, true poetic ambiguity proceeds from the deep division of being itself, and poetry does no more than state and repeat this division, end quote. Symbolism aspired to the ideal of incarnation, but allegory acknowledged the fundamental ambiguity or disparity within being itself. Quoting de Man again, the ambiguity poetry speaks of is the fundamental one that prevails between the world of the spirit and the world of sentient substance. To ground itself, the spirit must turn itself into sentient substance, but the latter is knowable only in its dissolution into non-being. Eliot had been right to observe that romanticism bore witness to the dissociation of sensibility, but that was precisely its poetic and metaphysical strength for de Man. Although he doesn't say so in quite so many words, de Man effectively concludes that Shelley, Wordsworth, and Hölderlin are the true metaphysical poets. In his critical response to Heidegger's commentaries on Hölderlin, he stresses the poet's unresolvable struggle to articulate the ineffability of being. One way to characterize this unresolvable struggle would be to say that it's an effort to identify a mythical sense of being, or rather to identify the primary sense with respect to which all other senses would be relative or, again, pros hem, equivocal. Metaphysical poetry in the full or wide sense is, for de Man, poetry that expresses not only the pros hem equivocity of being, but the impossibility of naming that which unifies the various senses of being. It is the type of metaphysical poetry with respect to which all other types of cross-hand are equivocal. Indeed, it's the type of metaphysical discourse with respect to which all other types of metaphysical discourse are cross-hand equivocal, which is to say, in other words, that metaphysics turns out to be a type of metaphysical poetry. So deconstructive criticism for de Man is the art of demonstrating this thesis, which rests on the assumption that being is inherently ambiguous. Now, whether we accept de Man's thesis will depend perhaps on whether we think ontology can be distinguished from rhetoric. With an eye toward determining whether such distinction can be drawn, I want to turn briefly now to José Benardete, who contrasts rhetorical tropes and ontological tropes. Rhetorical tropes are expressions that non-literally designate ways of being, while ontological tropes are expressions that literally designate ways of being. Benardetti's guiding idea is that if being is said in some primary way, for Aristotle, the way of substance, then all the other ways in which being is said can be characterized as ontological tropes. So cross-hen equivocity would then be essentially tropological, but wouldn't necessarily be rhetorical, at least if we're entitled to distinguish literal and non-literal expressions or uses of expressions. If poetics in the broad sense of the term, if poetics in the broad sense of the term is the study of the non-literal as opposed to the literal use of language, then de Man's thesis can be restated as the claim that metaphysics is one of the objects of poetic investigation. Benardetti puts this thesis to the test, not so much directly with de Man in mind, by considering the debate between Platonists and nominalists about the use of abstract singular terms. For a Platonist, an everyday expression such as the number of apples in this basket, is to be taken as literally referring to an abstract entity, right? Namely, the number of apples in this basket. But for the nominalist, it's to be taken as non-literally indicating some way in which the apples themselves are being considered. So Benardetti argues for several theses. First, metaphysical debates often turn on whether an expression is being used literally or non-literally. Second, curiously, to our surprise perhaps, is not the visionary Platonist, but the down-to-earth nominalist who insists on construing the number of apples in this basket non-literally, i.e. poetically. It's the nominalist who's poetic, not the Platonist. Third, quote, poetry and ontology alike may thus be seen to be incipiently emerging in the ambiguous role played by the abstract singular term in our mother tongue, end quote. By way of illustration and further complication, Benardetti considers the use of the abstract singular term, the anger of Achilles, in the first line of the Iliad. Does Homer use this phrase literally or non-literally, is his question. If non-literally, that is poetically, then it is just a tropological nominalization of the basic sentence Achilles is angry. But nothing prevents us from taking Homer to intend to use the trope literally and ontologically rather than non-literally and poetically. It would then refer not to a Platonic universal, namely anger, but to what the philosopher D.C. Williams calls a trope, a singular anger, Achilles' anger. So how are we to choose between these two interpretations, the literal and the non-literal? Or more to the point, can we choose in a way that would be non-arbitrary? Appealing, as de Man does, to Empson's seven types of ambiguity, Benardetti concludes that, quote, we should properly rejoice in the ambiguity of the anger of Achilles as to whether it is to be taken as involving an ontological or a rhetorical trope. After all, poetry revels in such ambiguity. To represent the anger of Achilles as a mere reification of a character trait would be to treat Homer's ambiguous poem as if it were a realist novel. And Getty observes. Against such a misreading, he praises, quote, the efforts of the French school to deconstruct the positivistic photorealism of the 19th century novel, end quote. If you don't know Benardini's work, the thing is that Benardini is a real hardcore analytic philosophy, primarily quoted from a book of his called Metaphysics, the Logical Approach, in which Aquinas is a great hero. So it's quite striking that deconstruction ends up getting this celebratory nod at this crucial point in his argument. To represent the anger of Achilles, says Eliot, correct, so again, read that. Restored to his rightful status as the epitome who founded Western culture, as we know it, Homer turns out to be the metaphysical poet par excellence here. According to Benardetti, the philosopher, quote, who has trained us to hear the music of ontological commitment to all sorts of discourse, quote, is not Heidegger, as it is for Dumont, but Quine. Quine's dictum, to be is to be the value of a variable, provides a strictly logical definition of the primary sense of being with respect to which all other senses are prosenni, equivocal. The litmus test for distinguishing between literal and non-literal uses of linguistic expressions is what one is prepared to quantify over, as one says in this discourse. What Benardetti characterizes as Quinean poetics is the art of determining as far as possible what objects a discourse includes in its ontology. Thus, Quinean poetics is to Dumontian deconstruction what logic is to allegory. Both rely upon while problematizing the distinction between literal and non-literal language. Benardetti's picture of Quinean poetics might be complicated a bit further by Hilary Putnam's observation that logical operators such as the existential quantifier are themselves equivocal. Given two disparate models of what there is, the very sense in which they disagree about what there is will be equivocal, since each model, according to Putnam, will have its own interpretation of the existential quantifier. According to Putnam, we cannot get around this problem by positing a common set of objects that rival conceptual schemes carve up in different ways, for there's no scheme-neutral use of the existential quantifier. According to Putnam here, what is wrong with the notion of objects existing independently of conceptual schemes is that there are no standards for the use of even the logical notions apart from conceptual choices, end quote. The logical operator that exists in X such that is said in as many ways as there are conceptual schemes. Even worse, there's no primary way with respect to which the others would be cross-hand equivocal. This is not to say that what there is completely up for grabs, because once we choose a particular scheme, we thereby fix a particular sense of the existential quantifier that is univocal relative to that scheme. Metaphysical pluralism only goes as far as scheme pluralism. It doesn't extend to things as they are in themselves, because it effectively does away with things in themselves. Still, this leaves Quinean poetics in the position of having to acknowledge that to be is to be the value of a variable is a radically equivocal formula, and not merely equivocal with respect to a primary sense. The very distinction between literal and non-literal uses of language must be regarded as radically equivocal. So where does this leave us? Does it follow that metaphysics itself is the highest form of metaphysical poetry, as Dumont seems to suggest? Or does it merely indicate that metaphysics and poetry are inextricably bound together, which I think is Benedetti's moral? In a famous passage from the Poetics, Aristotle writes in a 17th century translation that I thought I should quote in my talk about metaphysical poetry, poetry is more grave and philosophic than history, for truly history can instruct no further than the facts it relates given opportunity. 'Tis not so with poetry that keeps close to generals, and it is so much the more instructive and moral as general things surpass particulars. So history deals with particulars. Aristotle tells us poetry with generals or universals. Aristotle's thinking specifically of epic poetry and tragic poetry, which, while they represent particular people in particular circumstances, do so in such a way as to reveal the universals they embody. Homer's Iliad and Sophocles' Oedipus Tyrannus are metaphysical poems in a sense that is pros hen to the sense in which metaphysics, or first philosophy, deals with universals. The highest universal, although according to Aristotle it is and isn't a universal, is being. Being is said in many ways, but its primary sense is, again, that of substance. All other senses are pace candidati, ontological tropes. Each of these ontological tropes is a category: quality, quantity, relation, time, place, etc. Metaphysical poetry, in the Aristotelian sense, then deals with that which is universal with respect to each of these categories. Aristotle's emphasis on unity of time, place, and action in tragedy might be regarded as a way of highlighting those universals that are proper to each of these categories, the universals of a day, of occasion, of eve, etc. Aristotle reports that Sophocles said that he depicted human beings as they should be, while Euripides depicted them as they actually are. Aristotle seems to concur, but he doesn't conclude that whereas Sophocles was a true poet, Euripides was closer to an historian. Of the two, he regarded Euripides as the more tragic, and so possibly as the more poetic. But the idea that poetry deals with universals rather than with particulars suggested Aristotle had some reason to regard Sophocles as the true poet. Philip Sidney took Aristotle to claim that all poetry depicts things not as they are, but as they should be. Poetic invention required the poet to give a local habitation and a name only to the best and most instructive fictions. Johnson regarded it as a strength of Shakespeare's dramatic poetry that his characters represented universal types and not merely particular individuals. But I think we, having a more Euripidean sense of Shakespeare today, tend to feel the opposite way, at least in some sense. But whether we regard Shakespeare as more closely akin to Sophocles, as most favorable 18th century critics did, or as closer to Euripides, as perhaps I'm suggesting, Aristotle has suddenly given us an unexpected reason to regard Shakespeare as an exemplary metaphysical poet. James Bednarz, in a recent book, has noted that Grierson pointedly excluded Shakespeare from his anthology of metaphysical poetry. Under the influence of Johnson, Grierson regarded the extravagant conceit as the metaphysical trope par excellence. He therefore took Donne to be the founder of the genre that Johnson had associated primarily with Cowley. Bednarz shows, however, that Shakespeare's poem The Phoenix and Turtle can lay claim to being the first metaphysical poem in Johnson's and Grierson's restricted sense. Earlier critics, I mean earlier than Bednarz, such as George Saintsbury, had called attention to the poem's Donne-like characteristics, but Bednarz goes further in suggesting that Donne may have been influenced by Shakespeare rather than the other way around. Be that as it may, perhaps we have a reason to think of Shakespeare's more familiar works as exemplary metaphysical poems in a sense that is not only more general, but even primary. An issue is not only what all epic and dramatic poetry has in common, namely characterization and action, but something that is peculiar to Shakespeare, is the part I'm not going to get to. Frank Kermode brings out this dimension in a late essay of his called Eliot and the Shudder, S-H-U-D-D-E-R. Recalling a time when it was a paradoxical shudder, Kermode highlights Shakespeare's capacity to induce shuddering. Eliot professed to have shuddered at Charmian's last words in Antony and Cleopatra, "Ah, soldier." Kermode admires this line as well, but he goes one step further than Eliot by focusing on the final scene of The Winter's Tale, when Paulina makes Leontes and us shudder at the resurrection of Hermione. Quote, "The repentant Leontes is tormented by faint and presumably deceptive signs of life in the supposed statue of his dead wife until he says, still methinks there is an air comes from her. What fine chisel could ever yet cut breath? Still quoting Kermode here. However fine the workman, statues cannot be made to breathe, but we nevertheless experience this marvelous intermediate phase when stones magically refined to breath and the revelations of Hermione's living presence, another even greater miracle will follow. In this quiet critical remark, Kermode not only measures his distance from Eliot, but he also indicates what it is that perhaps gives Shakespeare's romances, in particular, their distinctively metaphysical flavor. Like Dumont and Benardetti, Kermode suggests that metaphysical poetry in the primary sense is poetry that hovers on the border between rhetoric and ontology, metaphysicality and metaphysics, wit and amazement. As Paulina puts it, it is required to do awake your faith. Okay, now, if I had a little more time, I would go on to talk just a little bit about Troilus and Cressida and a kind of sustained reading of this play. It's obviously not on Shakespeare's romances, but I think that there's something that's metaphysical that's going on in this play, which is very different from what I was just sort of extrapolating from Kermode, a different kind of metaphysical question, and one perhaps that brings very, that would bring Dumont into play in a certain way. So in this longer reading, which I won't go into here, what I start with is Derrida's final book, or the final book published in his lifetime, Rogues, Two Essays on Reason. He asks the question about what it might mean to save the honor of reason. And he suggests that it might be incumbent upon us in certain circumstances to save the honor of reason. And what he has in mind is something like the experience of Kant's antinomies, where reason finds itself in a kind of crisis situation. It's in conflict with itself. And Kant uses the term euthanasia. The antinomy threatens the euthanasia of philosophy. And so it's very important to come to the rescue of reason, to save the honor of reason. That's my constant phrase. And but what interests Derrida is a way in which some people know from his work about autoimmunity, the way in which he's developed the term autoimmunity in a philosophical context. As he conceives it, autoimmunity is the way in which something like a body, in order to protect itself from an external threat, attacks itself, and so essentially commits a kind of preemptive suicide. And Derrida's worry is a worry about reason doing something like that. When reason will verge on committing suicide, that's when we would say we have to save the honor of reason. So saving the honor of reason would not be saving it in the Kantian sense, where the emphasis is on restoring reason's unity, but rather it would be on a sort of farewell to reason, or a kind of farewell to the systematic architectonic demand for unity. And so I think that it's interesting to look at Troilus and Cressida with this question in mind, partly because Troilus and Cressida is so much structured like an antinomy in the way in which Shakespeare portrays the conflict between the Greeks and the Trojans. I like to look back to G. Wilson Knight's nice essay on the philosophy and Troilus and Cressida for this. And also because there are a number of philosophical arguments that come up in the course of Troilus and Cressida, including one in the council scene in Troy, where the Trojans are debating whether or not they should give Helen back to the Greeks. Nestor has sent a message for the umpteenth time saying, give her back, and that's it, we'll forgive everything. And so Priam convenes all the guys, and they're all going to decide whether or not they should do this. And Hector, who, of course, represents Trojan honor and glory, says that he thinks they should give her back. They should give her, not because he's afraid, Hector is not afraid, but reason argues for it, essentially. She's not worth the cost that they're taking on here. And Troilus responds in horror at this idea and really sort of attacks Hector for thinking that Priam should twice if we do that. And in any case, there's a rather sustained debate here, which is quite philosophical, so much so that at one point, Hector chides Troilus and Paris for being like those young men whom Aristotle said were unfit to hear moral philosophy. So somewhat anachronistically, Hector has read his Aristotle, and he's apparently also read his Euthyphro, because he's essentially arguing that it's mad idolatry to think that something has value because we value it, rather than the other way around. So I think that there's sort of a question that's posed in Troilus and Cressida about the value of reason and about the nature of honor. And I think that we see something very much like this sort of experience of autoimmunity that Derrida talks about. But we see it actually with Troilus. Troilus's defense of honor is what undergoes a kind of autoimmune attack. In other words, in the end, the task for Troilus, after he has lost Cressida to Diomedes and lost his horse to Diomedes, it's not clear which is the greater tragedy for him, I'm being facetious, the task for Troilus is really to save the honor of honor in a certain way. But there's a whole question about what it means to prefer honor to reason. And I just think that the metaphysical questions that come up in Troilus and Cressida are much more complicated, and that would be a better place for me to return to the Demonian issues and the Benardete issues than just to end with Frank Kermode as I did. So, okay, I'll stop here, and of course I'm happy to take questions. I thank you for your patience.
Before we go to
so I have a question. This is something we've talked about before, like judgment. You popped up there at one point in relation to resemblance as kind of a lumpers and splitters. So judgment on the table is on the splitting side and not really poetic. Or is that more literal and ontological? Could you say more how that fit into the big scheme? It went by very quickly at one point.
Right.
I was kind of curious on how you were parsing that.
Right. So on the one hand, you know, in terms of Locke and Cowley, the idea is supposed to be that wit is all about combination and judgment is all about separation. So not so much the poetic, but the metaphysical is associated with wit. But via Foucault, what I wanted to suggest is that Foucault talks about the transition from episteme based on resemblance to episteme based on representation. But this has something to do with thinking of the detection of resemblances. I mean, the comparison is the primary cognitive act for understanding the world versus distinguishing in some way. So that when we get natural philosophy and everything that comes with it, we're comparing in a new way, comparing, but only for the sake ultimately of identifying things. Everything is what it is and not something else becomes kind of fundamental ontological principle for classifying the world in a certain way. And so that whole kind of Linnaean task of classifying the world becomes what a good judge does. So the naturalist, you know, distinguishes the different species of butterfly, and that would be an activity of judgment. Whereas then the witty poet comes along and says why, in fact, the butterfly and the dog are really the same in some way. But at that point, it becomes metaphysically superficial because it is at a certain level just a matter of cleverness in a certain way, rather than deep metaphysical import. You know, compared to these people who Foucault talks about, from the earlier period, who would, like the book on snakes, I think
reminds me of, what's his name, Nelson Goodman. You know, when he tries to find a representation, he says you can never rely on resemblance, because at the end, everything resembles everything. And so we all resemble each other, because we're in this room right now, and that's a mode of resemblance. And in the end, you can always find something like that. And so that's sort of what the Foucault thing is doing to representation. That just gets rid of resemblance entirely as a mode of, an ontological mode, and becomes rhetorical, maybe.
Right. Right, and I don't want to get too much into a side conversation, but you know the conversation that you and I briefly had in SPEP, mm-hmm. I was asking you about Deleuze's idea about you know what it means to want to have done with judgment, and remember we talked about that a little bit, and we should follow up on that later.
Lots of background of a question.
Yeah, well, I guess what I would see as the you know, as a connection here is that in a certain way, Demand is trying to have done with judgment in a certain way. Perhaps Eliot as well, but there's some kind of suggestion that there is a truth in poetry that they're trying to recover, and that it's something to do with having done with judgment.
Yeah, Hölderlin often shudders Heidegger in the way that he politicizes the essence and the location of poetry and of a poet. So you talked about the importance of poetic symbols over against allegories in the way that they unify form and content, thought and sensibility. I was wondering if you could relate what Heidegger sees so great about Hölderlin in that sort of self-reflexive way in which he writes poetry to the importance of unifying thought and sensibility, form and content for metaphysical poetry.
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I mean, I think it's pretty clear that Demand thinks that Heidegger is moving towards a kind of allegorization of you know. But would I myself say that that's what Heidegger is doing with Hölderlin? You know, I'm not really sure. I'm kind of curious to hear what you think about it. Do you have any particular thoughts about that?
So you think that Heidegger is allegorizing what Hölderlin is doing?
I think Demand thinks that that's what happened to his doing.
Okay. What would that mean exactly for metaphysical poetry?
It would mean
that I haven't read Demand. I don't know the context of this discussion.
Well, it would mean really sort of suspending the longing for a certain form of incarnation or of symbolism. That which provides some kind of reconciliation between the natural and the supernatural. And a certain kind of sense of the destitution of being would be something that I think demands these kinds of finding and holding. I found this a little bit.
So it's something more like what your project is beyond this, that this is within, is it to find, kind of recover an access to truth that's not judgmental or that's poetic? And like at one point I was thinking Kant's symbolization, because you talked about symbol versus allegory, but you see a white lily, but you see not the white lily, but its pure innocence and its idea of insensible nature, but symbolized. It sounded like a similar thing to where the direction you're going. Is there a bigger philosophical project that you're pushing, that you're getting at here?
Well,
as
I say, it's a very exploratory project, at least in one sense. I don't exactly know where I'm going with this, but I think I'm probably going in two different directions, one of which is sort of taking me to Shakespeare's romances and sort of kind of traditional conception of metaphysics. And on the other hand, I'm trying to think about some way in which the suspension of judgment would open up a different way of thinking about metaphysics, whether via poetry or just philosophically. And very flat, and it makes me sort of wonder if we might want to have done with inference in a certain way. And I think it was this sort of question I had, what might it mean to have done with inference? That had led me to ask you, after your talk, why does Deleuze put the emphasis on having done with judgment rather than on having done with inference? And you kind of threw it back to me and said, well, what do you think, Andrew? And you also suggested that maybe somehow it's too tame just to do it that way. And afterwards I thought, yeah, I think that's right. And perhaps because assertion is the central unit of speech for Brandon, because he thinks assertion, that's what you can take responsibility for. It's the most fundamental unit of language for which we take responsibility. And what it means to take responsibility is to be held accountable for inferential moves of some sort. So then I thought, okay, well, so perhaps this is what Deleuze is getting at as well in a certain way. I don't know if it's true or not, but that there's something about judgment that brings us into this inferential game. And so in thinking about what Cowley might be arguing about with Locke, say, just on the cusp of this transformation from Renaissance sophisticated to the early modern one, to the extent that we can talk that way, that Cowley would be saying, you know, yeah, judgment is all well and good, but there is another way of engaging with the world. And there's something about the exercise of wit that that is deeper in some way. But he can't quite pull it off. And in fact, what he comes up with is mere superficial cleverness in a certain way. I mean, he's a very talented poet, but we don't come away from, no one reads Cowley for his metaphysics. And I'm not recommending that we do necessarily. I'm sorry?
Why should anyone? I work on poetry, and I'm a romanticist.
Okay. Well, I guess what I have in the back of my mind is a kind of longing for a Cowley to whom one would turn for substantive metaphysics in some way. Now, in the continental tradition that I've generally come out of, when people do that kind of thing, they do it by Heidegger in some way.
Yeah.
And invariably, it's just the German poets. And I guess I've just been trying to think about, okay, well, how might we do something analogous that wouldn't perhaps be quite exactly what Heidegger does, or let's see where we would go if we started reflecting on the history of this metaphysical poetic tradition. And so what I found, I think, is that I've ended up, on the one hand, it took me just to the metaphysics of the Winter's Tale. It's all about resurrection, and it is required to do excite your faith. I don't have the right verb. But on the other hand, I'm also drawn to this other side of Shakespeare. And what I sort of want to suggest is that there's another kind of wit that pervades Shakespeare's drama. And it is metaphysically deep in a certain way. And so taking that cue from this guy Bednar's, his book on Phoenix and Turtle, I'm sort of trying to think about, could we find in Shakespeare's drama metaphysical poetry of a different sort? It actually would be deeply metaphysical in a way that would somehow give us an alternative to Robert Brandon's view of the world. So then the natural hypothesis would be to say that there must be a deep connection between honor and wit. And perhaps there has something to do with the fact that when one finds oneself committed to a cause upon which one's honor is at stake, it is through a certain kind of arbitrary act of a certain sort that
I mean, one way of thinking about it is that there's the whole notion of taking responsibility in the inferential connection. That's what's responsible for it being too thin, right? Or another way of thinking about it is his conception of that for which we can take responsibility is too thin. I mean, the comments about honor just were sort of pushing me in that direction, right? That you might think that part of that sort of initial commitment of the honorable person to whatever random principle that they commit themselves to is precisely a commitment to a certain number of consequences. I mean, again, talking about them as inferential consequences maybe understates their significance or something like that. But you might think that for honor, precisely that commitment to those consequences and being sort of publicly bound to those commitments is a kind of essential part. So I guess another way of asking the question is, how close do you think the sort of very notion of those inferential connections is to the idea of judgment as dividing, right? So it might be that those are two separate phenomena. And it's the combination of those two that gives you the thinness in Brandom, but you could separate out the judgment stuff and do an inferentialism of honor, a witty inferentialism.
Yeah, that's very nice. I mean, you know, and in that council scene when Tarvis is defending, you know, the cause of keeping Helen, he gives a kind of an illustration, which is sort of ripped with irony because he's about to commit himself to Cressida, and that's going to all turn out disastrously. But he doesn't refer to that, but by example, he says, I take today a wife, and my election is led on by the conduct of my will. My will guided by the two pilots, I can't remember,
reason and passion.
You know, I think judgment is one of them. Will and judgment, as I recall. Will and judgment, and I can't remember all the lines here, but what he's precisely trying to think through are the existential commitments that one takes on. And you're right, there's kind of inferential logic to it. But an inferential logic of a different sort. It isn't so much as and of course, I can just hear Brandon saying it. In the end, you know, it's all about reasons in some way, and Freud really is giving his reasons. Would have a reason to be bound in this way. But Freud is right; he's undertaking a different kind of commitment, and to be honored bound. I mean, clearly, right? It's got kind of a structural similarity to being inferentially bound. Someone else could reconstruct it that way, but there would be a talking past each other. You know, in the play, it's Ulysses who represents reason. And in general, the Greeks, in general, the Trojans stand for honor, and the Greeks stand for reason. So even in that council scene when Hector is making the claim that they should side with reason, but then he has a complete 180 at the end of the speech, and he says, Hector's opinion is missing way of truth, but nevertheless, my sprightly brethren, I do pretend that we keep her still, for she hath no mean dependence on our joint and several dignities. So, right after giving perfectly good reason for why they should give her back, he's like, yeah, that's just reason, you're right, you know, it's all about honor. And the Greeks are all about reason, but also cynicism. Their reason is a very cynical reason, so that with the Trojans, it's all about a certain kind of idealism of a certain sort versus an intellectual cynicism. And what troubles Ulysses is that the hierarchy of command has been violated. So in their council scene, he gives a speech about the violation of rule and degree. Degree, it's all about where you are in the hierarchy and following the rules in a certain way. And the wonderful scene, the most wonderful scene probably the play is in the fifth act when Troilus has been forced to allow Cressida to be handed back over to the Greeks in exchange for Antenor. And she's sworn that she'll be faithful, but he doesn't trust her. And he's over in the Greek camp, and Ulysses enables him to see Cressida give his love token to Diomedes. And it's, one thing I love about this scene is that Ulysses does what Iago does in Othello. Iago disabuses Othello. And he doesn't disabuse him, but he deceives him, obviously, right? But what motivates Iago? That's, of course, a huge question in itself. But I think that one of the things that motivates Iago is that he wants to destroy the kind of idealized love of Othello and Desdemona. And so he can't give Othello the octave proof that he demands of Desdemona's infidelity, but he can kind of rig something that looks like it. What's interesting about Troilus and Cressida is Ulysses plays a similar role with respect to Troilus and Cressida, and he actually can give Troilus octave proof because the double of the handkerchief is the sleeve that Troilus has given Cressida, which now she gives to Diomedes as Troilus watches. And so there are two completely different worldviews that Troilus and Ulysses represent. And again, I think it's the antithesis between reason and honor in a certain way. So I thank you, Chris, for this, you know, great suggestion, but I don't quite know how to work out what the details would be of this other way of being bound to a commitment. But I do think that Shakespeare is not simply celebrating honor over reason. It's more complicated than that. And that, again, I think where he raises a question that goes beyond the one that Derrida raises in a Rogue is that it really becomes a question of what it means to save the honor of honor insofar as Troilus' whole plan goes terribly awry. It's all a disaster. Hector gets killed, and the whole question is, who will tell Hector? Who will tell Hector this news? Well, one of the things that fascinates me is that Kant, in a particular reason, twice invokes Hecticum at the fall of Troy. Once in the preface to the first edition of Critique of Pure Reason, and once towards the end in the chapter on the, I can't remember now, on the discipline of pure reason. And that's the first time it's Ovid's Hecuba, and the second time it's Virgil's Hecuba. The first time it's Hecuba saying, greatest of all I was, but now I am outcast and forlorn, something like this. What Kant wants to do is save the honor of Hecuba. He identifies metaphysics with Hecuba. And the queen of the sciences, as he calls her. And the contrast is between the queen of the sciences and what he calls indifferentism, the mother of chaos and night. So the queen, good mother and bad mother, guiding Kant's whole poetic setup here. And then the chapter on discipline, he comes back to Hecuba again. He's been talking about the antinomies and the fact that in the antinomies, they only kind of remain in force as long as we don't see that neither side can offer a direct proof of its claim, but each side can only progress by attacking the other side. All the proofs are apodictic rather than direct or extensive. So the old rationalist metaphysics is structured in that way. And Kant quotes Virgil's Hecuba saying to Priam during the sack of Troy, the time doesn't call for these defenses. It's too late for these defenses. So, you know, a lot of what I'm really doing is I like to look for the little sort of poetic moments in these texts and see, okay, you know, how far can I push a kind of literary critical reading of, say, the Critique of Pure Reason without going quite as extravagantly far as Derrida does, because I think Derrida does go a little too hyperbolically far with his readings. But how far can we go in sort of rethinking what a metaphysical text is and how the history of modern philosophy has sort of suppressed but also inherited in a certain way, certain underlying poetics that informs our overall picture of the world.
Could you write a parallel paper to this on the idea of metaphysical comedy? Like, the comedy can be a way of getting the metaphysics. Like, it's tragedy, yes, but like Much Ado About Nothing, that seems to summarize what everything's about comedy.
Yeah, yeah. think you could. I mean, one of the things about Protestant Cressida that's funny is that it's very difficult to classify generically. It's not exactly a comedy because it doesn't end with marriages, but it's not exactly a tragedy either because Hector's death is too sort of because Achilles kills him in such a slovenly way, essentially. But in other words, first, yes, but also for this impressive, I think it's interesting because you can't really quite classify it as a tragedy or a comedy, exactly. And also with the romances, people will often say that in these late romances of Shakespeare, he's breaking the divide between tragedy and comedy in some way. So it might be that there's some way in which the metaphysical particularly comes through where these genres are being broken down. So I definitely don't need to be privileging the tragic over the comedy. And perhaps not the least of privilege of comic. Okay. Hegel privileges the comic, though, with the tragic. Okay. His lectures on aesthetics, the comedy is the highest form of art. So, you know, we get these tragic collisions, the ethical collisions, but comedy dissolves them. And in a sense, the whole, you know, Bacchanalian revel, you know, in which everyone ends up drunk at the end, if not of the spirit, suggests that phenomenology of spirit is one large. So I think, you know, the way to interpret the final scene with the goal of the absolute spirit is in terms of life with rhyme. It's a life with rhyme.
Yeah, I really appreciated your talk. It was incredibly interesting and rich. However, I was really interested by what you said in looking for the poetic moments in philosophical texts and how far you could push them. Because up to that point, I was kind of thinking that you're assuming that poetry is subordinate to philosophy, and for poetry to be worth anything, it has to be metaphysical in some way. Did I mishear you? Because that remark about finding the poetic moments in philosophy sounded extremely different, if not exactly the reverse of that. But part of me thinks that to see poetry as something to find metaphysical significance in might be to radically misrecognize poetry. Your talk was wonderful. I don't mean that to sound as hostile as it sounds.
No, it doesn't sound hostile. I think it's a perfect question. Yeah.
I think I'm done.
The first thing that I would say is that I'm certain that argue for didactic poetry.
That would be a very different kind of. If we're talking about the usual, didactic poetry.
Right. So I'm not saying that, say, Lucretius is true because the paradigm of poetry, say, and that all poetry should aspire to that character. I think what might have given the impression of subordinating poetry to philosophy is what I was trying to suggest, that that we might have a reason to be interested in poetry that counts as metaphysical, not only in the formal sense, but in material, contentful sense. But I don't think that what metaphysical poetry in that double sense would be just a kind of dressing up of theorems or arguments that we would could just as easily lay out another way.
Yeah, that was not what I was taking you to be saying. But it's the whole idea, I guess, that poetry is something to look for metaphysical significance in.
Right. Okay, and then I guess I would say not necessarily all poetry. I don't mean to suggest that all poetry ought to be metaphysical.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but of course I've asked myself, do I want to say that somehow, nevertheless, all poetry does have some kind of metaphysical dimension? Now, I guess I'm not sure what I want to say about that.
Mm-hmm.
But
what about the poetic dimension?
Well, I guess I wouldn't quite oppose the metaphysical and the poetic dimensions. I wouldn't.
Yeah, I mean,
kind of describes what a judgment of taste involves.
In
a judgment of taste, one is responding to a form that has gotten one thinking, has stimulated one's thinking in such a way that one feels the pleasure of ongoing thought, and also feels and recognizes the inadequacy of any concept to characterize that form. So when we're genuinely dealing with a work that we characterize as poetic, I would say, we're very well aware of the fact that no judgment, no determined judgment could ever be adequate to the form that's stimulating us. So perhaps what I would say then is that the poetic dimension is precisely that in the work which resists while stimulating our thoughts about it in some way. And I want to preserve that.
It's thought not related to concepts. Thought not dependent on concepts.
Well,
because an aesthetic judgment, it's without concept.
Right. So the way that Kant does this is to distinguish between types of judgment, determined judgment and reflective judgment.
Yeah.
And what he suggests is that in reflective judgment or in aesthetic reflective judgment, our understanding, our capacity for thinking conceptually is in play as a whole. So there's no one concept that we can find in our repertoire or can invent that will sum up this object, but the entire capacity for thinking conceptually has been engaged by our encounter with the work.
Okay, I have to talk to you a bit of
We're starting to run a little short on time. Yeah. So we're starting to run a little short on time, but I'm going to abuse my organizational power to ask you one last question because I've had it on my mind. I really appreciate your admission that your work right now is exploratory, because it seems like a lot of metaphysicians classically have had sort of a program and they lay out a sort of systematic answer to that program. Do you see a kind of a need for an exploratory metaphysics? One that's not programmatic or systematic as a kind of alternative to an approach, as a way to maybe save the honor of metaphysics, so to speak?
I'm not sure what to say about that, but maybe because I'm not entirely sure what would count as exploratory here. But I think that Kant's question is very much the question of what it means to save the honor of metaphysics. And perhaps in a certain way I'm taking up that question. So that may be part of why I'm getting stuck with some of these questions.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
And thanks, everyone.